Aloha, it's Katie, and today we're gonna talk about the IB because I can't seem to get away from it. As you guys may know, I am currently at Cornell University starting my freshman year, which is what I've been doing over the past few weeks. If you're curious about my life here on a day-to-day basis, then you should follow me on social media at AlohaKatieX or subscribe to my vlog channel because I have actually been uploading every week. Same with my main channel. I think I'm actually getting my life together. So ever since I did my IB reaction video and then my Having Got a 45 video, a lot of you guys have been asking me to do subject-specific videos, and I never thought I would be one of those, you know, tutor kinds of videos like Richard Thornley, or I don't know, because I would watch them and now I feel like them, but I'm still young, I'm still a college student. But as much as possible, of course, you guys know I read your comments and I want to help as much as I can. So today I'm going to try to talk more about each of my six subjects, the TOK, EEIA, and some advice that I think will help you guys. If you're new to my channel, you should subscribe down below to join our Alohana, which is what we call our family of subscribers. And while you're down there, you should click the bell to turn my notifications on, and if you do both, I give free shoutouts like these wonderful people on screen. Just don't be a silent viewer, comment on my videos, I love replying. Include Aloha in your comment if you want a shoutout specifically, and check back next video because it might just be you. So the IB subjects I did were HL, Computer Science, Economics, and Language and Literature. Then I did SL Math, Chemistry, and Chinese. So I know some of you may not have these same subjects, but I'm sure you were required to take a subject that was under one of the overarching categories, like the Natural Sciences or Language Acquisition. So even if you didn't take these specific subjects, I still think these tips will help you because they are under the same category, and I feel these subjects more or less have similar testing styles and will ask questions similarly, and I'd imagine that you'd also study these subjects similarly. So first I'm going to talk about chemistry, because in my experience I hear a lot about experimental sciences being a bit more hard, just more time consuming, and for me especially, even though chemistry was an SL, so chemistry was just not one of my strongest subjects, and miraculously on the exam I managed to get a 7 on chemistry, and like straight 7s, which is crazy because it was my worst subject, and I would get like 6s, 5s, even 4s in that class throughout the year. So there you go. So I have a lot to talk about that class in particular. So just a recap of chemistry. So what I did was I had 3 papers. I had paper 1, which is multiple choice, paper 2, which was a long answer response, and then 3, which was the option paper. I did medicinal chemistry option D, by the way. So most throughout the year, my holy grail or a most helpful resource for chemistry is first the official IB textbook, second the study guide, and third Richard Thornley, originally MSJ Chem. So the first two are official IB resources, official textbooks. You cannot go wrong if you follow them because they are official textbooks that cover the entire syllabus. These should be your guiding book while you study chemistry. I believe mine was the Oxford one. It looks like this. I'll pop it on screen right now. Then the second two, Richard Thornley and MSJ Chem, are both YouTubers because honestly, sometimes I just get bored of studying, just reading a lot. So I like to watch videos. I am a YouTuber, so I like making videos and watching other videos. So and watching other YouTubers, so I gotta support. Sometimes I used to watch Richard Thornley at first because he plays a video game. I still don't know what the game is, but he plays a game and incorporates chemistry in a really fun way, though sometimes it does drag a bit. But normally, if you skip to the end of the Richard Thornley part when he goes to his black screen and he writes things out, that's when the actual lesson starts. But if you're looking for something more concise and to the point, then try MSJ Chem, because I was trying to learn a lot of medicinal chemistry during mocks or towards the final exams, and MSJ Chem was a very good resource, just very straight to the point. I would suggest looking through their website first and not directly through their YouTube channel. That's how I did it, and they have videos on everything. So really, chemistry people, these will save you. Maybe there are some for bio and physics too, but and other sciences too. I just know those for chemistry, and you know, just give it a YouTube search. Another thing that's important for all of these experimental sciences, formulas and units. You will probably have to memorize some formulas and units. Yes, they might give you the data booklet or give it to you in the question, but chances are it is better to just have that in your head because it's going to take time to open up that data booklet and check them equations, just have them in your head, and it'll be much easier to go through problems. Of course, if you're really not sure, you can consult it, but The more you memorize, the less you have to consult that thing, and the more time you have to work on the problems. Also, memorize generic equations. So for chemistry, there was a lot of, you know, like acid plus metal oxide equals. Those are important. They do ask a lot of questions to do with balancing equations, writing out word equations, all those things. When you do labs in school, pay attention, and this is honestly a problem I had, but you know, enjoy the lab because those are always fun. But also realize what you're doing, pay attention to the procedure, what you're adding, what amounts, the mole ratios, all that stuff, because it could be asked on the test. There are some essential labs that will probably be asked, especially for paper 3 or option D. As you may know, paper 3 is split up into two sections. So the first part is practical lab work, and the second part is the actual option. So first half had to do, I think, topics 10 and 11, which had to do with laboratory skills. So you will want to know your essential labs. And then for the second part, that's when you study your energy, medicinal chemistry, or biochem, those options. Next thing is make sure you are using the correct terminology and vocab, especially for paper 2 when you have to do long responses. If you look at the mark scheme, most of the time they bold certain keywords and they give you a point if they see that keyword. So you really need to know exactly what the term is, like osmosis. Instead of explaining what osmosis is for medicinal chemistry and being like, when? I don't remember. Okay, I don't remember that stuff. I'm done with the chemistry. But you know, and just make sure you know the terminology. It can save you a lot of time because most times examiners are just looking for that keyword, and if they see you have it, you are good. No need to babble on and give useless fluff that's not gonna score you points. Oh, sorry, here's a better example I actually know. Instead of saying a proton donor and acceptor, just say amphoteric. That's the term. Oh, this is a really good one. Look at how many points a question is worth. You don't realize it, but these are huge hints at what they're actually asking. If you're doing one of those long questions, those experimental questions where they're telling you you have to find the moles, find the concentration, those kinds of things, they are normally huge questions with multiple steps. If you are stumped on a question but you notice that it's only one point, then you can deduce that you probably have to do a very simple calculation with something you already have. So if you found the moles for something in the first question, and in the second question they ask you for the moles of another thing, and you're like, what do I do, but you see it's one point, then you're probably going to use your previous answer and use that for the current question you're working on. So if you know the ratio is just 1 to 2, then you just multiply your previous answer by 2 and you get that new equation. It's probably going to be very straightforward if it's one mark. That said, if you really have no idea how to do one question but you know how to do the questions after that, just come up with a guess. Even if you don't think it's right, just use that number of moles or the value you got and just use that for the rest of the questions after, because that way, even if you don't get the correct answer, you can get error carried forward, or ECF, which gives you points if you show that you have the correct methodology and that you know how to do it. If you had gotten that one question right, then all your values would have matched up, but otherwise, you will get points. So you might lose one point for the one you got wrong, but if you just keep going and use that value forward, then you can get points for the next few questions because you show that you know the methodology and how to approach it. Also, read the questions and see what information they're giving you. There was a time for my mocks when it was a 3-page question, so you know, here, here, then here. But I was at the back already, and I had forgotten that the original question had given me information because I was stuck on the last question. I was like, how do I solve this? I don't have the information. Whenever you think you are missing information, read the question again. They're normally in big paragraphs with information that will probably help you because they're not gonna give you something you can't solve. So we were deciding between energy and medicinal chemistry. But energy, I guess, is more of a controversial issue right now with renewable energy and all of that. And medicinal was known to have a lighter load, so how they compared it was that energy is more for mathematical people because there are a lot of equation solving, whereas medicinal chemistry, it was more logic, memorizing a lot of content and just busting that out. In my opinion, I am not a very math fond person. I am not a very mathematical genius person, so I preferred just doing medicinal chemistry. I felt that was more applicable in my life to learn about medicine, and also I just found it easier to memorize a lot of content and, you know, bust that out on the exam, because the vibe I got was that energy has to do with more conceptual things. So if you didn't get a question, then that's over, you know, then you don't get it, you're done and you can't solve it. And because I took the exam, I agree, but a lot of it was just textbook knowledge. If you read the textbook, if you did your studying, you will know the answer. You don't need to struggle there, you know, in a math exam and try to think of a solution, so it should be easier to put from your brain to your paper. And with all of these subjects, I will just keep stressing that you just need to do the past papers. I did all of them. Really get the hang of it. You start to understand what examiners are looking for, what will score you points, especially when you check it with a marks team after. These resources are available to you online. Just search up IB. You know the internet, you can find what you need. So do your past papers. This brings me to my second subject, math, which everyone has to take. Math, really, the way I study was just past papers. Since day one, my class just did past papers and past papers. The practice we did in class was past papers. I can't recall a time when we didn't do past papers. Yeah. I'm not sure about the math textbook, but I know there are just so many questions for math, also because math has a question bank. So aside from the past papers with questions themselves, you also have a question bank, which is best way to go. Of course, I think taking notes is still important because you need to write the formulas and stuff. So in that way, compare your math learning objectives or the syllabus to what you're doing and take notes accordingly. Then if you don't know how to approach a problem, go see your teachers, go ask your friends. A lot of people can help you, tutor you, mentor you. So my best advice is always to take a step back, and if you can't see the bigger picture or the final picture you're meant to get to, just start step by step and look at what information you're given. With the information you're given, think of what formulas you have that involve those. And if you do think of a formula, which you normally will, then you plug it in, and after that you will get a new value then you might be able to use for something else. So normally I get somewhere during that process, or I realize something, and then you come up with more solutions. And the more working you show, the more likely you're gonna get points. You know, always writing something down is better than leaving the question blank. Also for math, when you're writing your final answer, first, if it's a calculator question, show all your working. If it's a calculator question, and you should draw or sketch a graph on your paper as working and show how you got that. So if you did the x-intercept, draw a graph and then mark the x-intercept, put the x and the y value, the complete value, and then when you're writing your final answer, still write down the full value of that and then simplify it at the end. So first make it equals the full giant value on your calculator, and then summarize it later with approximation sign and round it to 3 sig figs, 2 decimal places. Always write down the full value, because even if you somehow round your final answer wrong, in your second to last line, you would have had the full value, and then they will just, the markers will take that and you will get a point. So just safe and sorry, I always did that. Okay, now for the third subject, language and literature, English, and just the whole language acquisition. Just a recap of that, the first paper we got was we would get article or some text type. We would be given 2 sets of 2 text types, and then we would have to choose one and compare the text types to one another and write a persuasive essay about that compares and contrasts these 2 text types. So in that case, I would always start out with an outline or a plan. Well, actually, this depends on how you work. You know how you study better, but in my case, I like to have a rough outline first of what I'm going to do. So what I do, actually, maybe for the first 20 minutes, I will read the article, I will annotate and highlight and just try to find evidence that I'm going to use for my essay. To make that work though, you will need to know what devices or how you're going to organize your essay. So I knew that going into that test, I knew I wanted to talk about imagery, because they always have some kind of imagery. And if they didn't have imagery, I would talk about figurative imagery. I was always like comparing visual versus figurative imagery. And then I'd probably talk about tone. And then for the third one, I would talk about persuasive techniques, which includes pathos, logos, ethos, and you know, those kinds of like bandwagon appeal or fallacies, persuasive techniques like that. So that way, when I was annotating my text types in the first few minutes, I knew what specifically I was looking for. And finding evidence, I think, is a good approach because it follows the PEEL method or structure, which is P is you make appeal. So first you say your point, E, you give evidence for it, and other E, you explain it. Then L, you link it to the next appeal you're gonna do or the next paragraph. So that way examiners can follow your essay very clearly. It's very important. Organization, I'm pretty sure, is one of the strands on the rubric, so make sure it has a clear structure. That way your examiner can have a easy time following your essay and will probably be more generous and give you marks in that section at least. For paper 2, what we had to do was we would be given 6 prompts, and we would have to, or six prompts, like, how is love portrayed in two of the texts you have studied, or, you know, like, give me something probably more specific, but you will have to use the text types, the poems, or books you read in class, and use them as evidence for this essay. So, some schools, some people will come up with canned essays, as in they will already write out a pre-planned generic essay with all their quotes, their explanations, evidence, and things like that. And then when they go to the exam day, whether or not they will force that essay into the prompt and just readjust some parts of their essay so that it answers the prompt. You need to memorize your quotes for the poem or the book you're using. You don't need to put the page number, which is what I was worried about at first. You don't have to do that, but you do need to have quotes because evidence is important. You can't, how can you prove something if you don't have evidence, you know? For the written tasks, one of them we had to write a creative piece where we had to emulate an author or some kind of text type and then justify why we wrote it like that. Then the other written task was an analysis. I'd say approach it the same way. Talk to your teacher, they will help you. I can't say too much on this because it really depends on what topic you do and which unit you get it from. My experience is probably different, so generally though, just look at the rubric always and see what is asked of you. That way you know exactly what you're supposed to do for this task. For the IOC, which was the oral commentary, try to sound confident, don't stutter too much. The same thing I feel for English, a common pattern is just to have an outline, know the literary devices you're going to talk about for each passage, know the themes of the overall book, and talk about that and how your quote contributes to that theme, or even how the context, cultural context, or the setting. And that was a mouthful, but I really hope that helped. I'm trying to bestow all the IB knowledge I had, and give this video a thumbs up if you found it helpful. If you want to see more IB videos, you should subscribe down below to join our Alohana. I upload new videos every week. You know, if you're curious, you can follow me on social media at AlohaKittyX. Scan my Snapchat on your right and click the top right eye to watch more of my videos. I have been really consistent on my vlog channel, actually, and I'm doing a lot of COD vlogs, so be sure to check those out, and I will see you next week with another new video. Thank you for watching. I love you to paradise and back. Bye, guys. Good luck.